Sunday dinner after the worship service. Our Operation Christmas Child Out of the Month for April is ivory soap and toothbrushes, so be on the lookout for those items. Alright, we met and exceeded our Annie Armstrong Easter offering goal, $1,350. You can still give today if you haven't given yet, so we can make that happen, and Ray will be sending that off tomorrow. And our spring in the fund was rescheduled from yesterday to next Saturday, April the 23rd, at 1 p.m. The Easter egg hunt, bouncy house, slide, cornhole, I cannot say that word more. Hot dogs and fellowship, everyone's invited. And do we have any other announcements that need to be made? No other announcements. In our Sunday school hour, we had 33 in attendance, an offering of $436. We had 40 contacts turned in. We appreciate that. I'd like to recognize those who've had a birthday in the past week. Anybody? Who are you pointing at? 404. What?
Just an empty shell. back inside the house, the guilt and anguish pain. Everything I promised him just added to my shame. When at last it came to choices, I denied I knew his name. And even if he was alive, it could never be the same. But suddenly the air was filled with a strange and sweet perfume. Love was shining out from him like sunlight from the sky.
this song kept coming to my, and I know every Easter this song comes to me, and I asked him if they didn't mind doing this today. And I tell you what, just sit back and let's let this work, this song here just minister to your heart. You know, as a Christian here today, you know, if we do serve a risen Savior and the reason he's alive, if that don't do anything for you, I tell you what, something's wrong. But if you're today, if you're lost and undone, don't know Jesus Christ, Lord and Savior, I tell you what, Jesus has the answer. Amen. He's the only way, the truth, and the life. But at this time, y'all give a hand for the drum. turn to 1 Corinthians chapter 15. And I will say this, this morning as we look to the scripture, I know at this day being Resurrection Sunday, it's amazing what Jesus Christ has done for each and every one of us. Amen. And, I know today, you know, we can sit around and there, I know at Easter, most of the time, you're going to be preaching messages surrounding that. And this scripture kept coming to my mind. And I know Paul, as we look to the scripture here in 1 Corinthians chapter 15, there's no way I could preach all 58 verses. But I believe it's a very, and today, whether this afternoon or tomorrow, just whenever you have a chance, bookmark that, 1 Corinthians chapter 15, and read it, the whole thing for yourself. We're going to touch on some things here, and we know that Paul, and I will say this, I guess, kind of getting ahead of myself. I know Brother John mentioned it this morning, just about our last Sunday. Our last Saturday, I guess, the women's event. I just want to say I appreciate all the ladies that participated. I know they had a great day. And I know last Sunday, Youth Sunday, you know, Brother Nathan and Wyatt, Nathan led music, Wyatt preached. Y'all may not know this, but Wyatt's been preaching like 2 or 3 months. I mean, and he accepted the call to think about God using him in a mighty way. And God said, let there be light. But to think about why, and I will say this, you know, we had a good time, I know, Sunday night with Bradley Walker, and I know we probably should have, as Johnny mentioned this morning, maybe give him a shout out. You probably didn't realize this, but he was started off in Townley, Alabama that week. He was going to the Grand Ole Opry on Tuesday night. So he just kind of, you know, he didn't go really to the Grand Ole Opry. That's kind of the mecca, I guess you could say, of singing and country music and also gospel music as well. That's what they sang that night. But going back to revival, I know Brother Brian Bridges, Brother Josh, and Hannah. Y'all, I'm going to sit down, y'all. I'm trying to kind of give y'all time to sit down. Pretty like sit down. But Josh and Hannah Jones, they led their music. Y'all that were here, I'm telling you, it was a blessing, wasn't it? Just a huge blessing. And Brother Brian Bridges, he brought some anointed preaching. There's a difference between preaching just to preach a sermon that maybe encourages you or just to, you know, tell you what's good that you do, that you'd like to hear. But I'll tell you what, he preached from the Word of God. And I say all that to say this. When we get down to the resurrection, you know, there's a lot of important events that's happened in the Bible. We know that Jesus was born of a virgin. We know that he lived a sinless life. We know he went to die. We know that he was buried. But today, if there is no resurrection, there's no gospel. If there's no resurrection on that third day, there's no gospel. Amen? Amen. There's no and you can talk about the Ten Commandments. You can talk about, you know, the Sermon on the Mount. There's a lot of important things in Scripture. But again, if there's no resurrection, there's no gospel. And the series of facts that we see all through Scripture is concerning Jesus Christ. And I thank him to know he's alive. Amen. Amen. He's alive. There's a lot of other religions that's got bones in the ground and worse than certain things. But we know that Jesus Christ, he lives forever and ever. It's eternity. But today, if you go to 1 Corinthians chapter 15. So the first thing we need to ask, I guess, ourselves is what is the gospel? What is the gospel? Now, we look at verses 1 through 4, and as I said earlier, this is a wealth of information in these 58 verses. I can't preach every one of them. I wish I could, but I'm telling you, it's just as I kept studying this week, thoughts coming to me, what God has laid on our heart today. I just want to encourage you to read it for yourself. It's very good. But notice Paul in verses 1 through 4, we're going to start there. It says, moreover, brethren, I declare unto you the gospel which I preached unto you, which also ye have received and wherein ye stand, by which also ye are saved, if you keep in memory what I preached unto you, unless you have believed in vain. For I delivered unto you, this is Paul here, I delivered unto you first of all that which I also received, how that Christ died for our sins according to the Scriptures, and that he was buried, and that he rose again the third day according to the Scriptures. Let's go, and when he talked about the Scriptures there, we're here in the New Testament, he's talking about the Old Testament Scriptures as he's talking about there. So we're going to see it later on, even in the Old Testament, what Jesus Christ has done for each one of us. He loves you today. You may be sitting here today and you think, well, I'm here, I'm sitting on a pew. Yes, I know it's Easter, but God has got something in store for you today through his word. Just let that Holy Spirit, let the word resonate in your heart. And today I pray that if anybody hears that calling, if anybody hears that knock on that heart's door, that they'd be willing to let him in, because Jesus can handle it. Amen. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. God, we just thank you for many blessings. Thank you for your grace. Thank you for your mercy. Thank you for this wonderful day. I thank you for, God, this message in song and the dramas, God, just all that you've done, God, for us. And I pray in the name of Jesus today, God, that we would do everything that's for your glory and honor. God, that you would preach, God, this message laid on my heart. I pray, God, you would take me out of the way that they only see your son, Jesus. God, thank you for allowing us to be here today, allowing us to come here. We know that God is a celebration, and I know it's very important that we preach the resurrection. God, we preach the gospel, and God, we love you, and we praise you, and we pray all this again in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. But what's the gospel? We see here that it talks about that he died. Now, he died. That is a historical fact. He died. But notice also it says he was buried and rose again. Let's say that with me this morning. He died, he was buried, and rose again. Let's say it again. He died, he was buried, and he rose again. And the gospel does not tell us something that, as far as what we must do, but what it's telling us is what Jesus Christ has already done for each and every one of us. He's done it for us. He was buried. Now, a lot of times you think, well, he's died and buried. Yes, that's, you know, that's something that's a given. But why does it make mention of him being buried? You know, why is being buried important? And I believe this is something that I was thinking about this week, because if he wasn't buried, you know, they would think, well, he just disappeared. He went here, went there, kind of hid until he could come on that resurrection Sunday. But he was buried. It means that they literally had his body, amen, in the tomb, in the grave. And we know today that he is risen. We know just like this cardboard tomb, guess what? It's empty. Amen. The tomb is empty. So we can celebrate this Resurrection Sunday. Now, if we look a little further in this scripture that we're looking at today, if we go to 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verse 12, as I said, you can't preach the whole thing, but notice what it says here. There were some within the Corinthian church that was teaching this in verse 12. It says, now Christ be preached that he rose from the dead. How say some among you that there's no resurrection of the dead? So that's what they was trying to preach, and that's what they was trying to teach, I should say. Now, but we know that as far as Paul was concerned, he wrote this, he addressed this error that they were teaching, and he was trying to get this firmly in their hearts and the minds of the saints. Now, he wrote this chapter on this subject. And when we look at verses 1 through 4, I'm not going to read them again, but notice that he delivered just what he received. Amen? And that's the thing about anointing. I know this last week we've seen the anointing on the preaching and the singing and the teaching that we saw this last week. And that's what's very important is Paul received Jesus. He received that gospel. Even later on, he talks about being the chief among sinners, which we can all relate to that as Christians if we're honest. But today, we look at verse 20. When we think about the resurrection, we think about what we call Easter Sunday. We see the resurrection of Christ. Now, the Christ of the Scriptures must die, he must be buried, and he must rise again. You know, how do we know? How do we know that happened? Now, let me ask you this. And I know y'all know someone of a crime, how many witnesses do you need to have, at least?
One.
A lot of times they want at least two. Just pretend like our church, something, we didn't have our camera system up, and Norm's sitting across the road on the porch, which if you don't know, he's got the longest drive back home, commute back home from church, but right across the street, he's sitting on this porch, he sees somebody comes out, and they're stealing stuff in the church, they see a truck, he notices the license plate, he knows who it is. He's got eyewitnesses of who stole from the church. You got Johnny coming down, coming to mow her grass. He's got his truck and his lawnmower coming around the corner. He notices the same thing. Just say you got two eyewitnesses of who stole from the church. Are we going to say that they're wrong in what they're doing? As a church, what are we going to do? We know we can trust them. We know we can believe them. And two witnesses, hey, that guy committed a crime. Right? Well, let's think of this just for one second. And this may be for somebody here, but know that the resurrection of Christ, it was proved by his rising from the dead. Notice, we're going to go back a little bit to verse 5 and verse 8 of 1 Corinthians chapter 15. And notice here it says who's it talking about he here? Let's talk about Jesus. It says that he was seen of Cephas, which that is Simon Peter. So that's one, right? That saw him. Yes or no?
Yes.
That's one. And then the 12. Now Judas, he had already killed himself. He isn't waiting, but they were still referred to as the 12. So now we know at least 11 has spotted him, right? They saw him. He was seen of the 12. And it says, after that, he was seen of above 500 brethren at once. Now, at least 500 people there, because the word above there, if you look in the Greek, means more than. It's epinos, I think. It's E-P-A-N-O. Everybody say that. I'm not no English major. But I'm not a major Methodist, so you know. We see that it's above more than 500 brethren. So now we know at least more than 500 people saw him after the resurrection. Are you following? We're there? And then it says, of whom the greater part remain unto this present, but some are falling asleep. That's meaning some of them have died. It also says, after that, he was seen of James. Then of all the apostles. Now that wasn't just, I know a lot of times they were mentioning the 12, but that could be applied to anybody that was a Christian teacher at that time. It could be Paul, it could be Timothy or Silvanus, but what that means is they are an ambassador of God. It's one that is sent. And then notice what it says, and last of all, he was seen of me. Who's me? That's Paul. Paul. He was seen of me. Also of the one born out of due time. So that's a lot of people, right, that seen Jesus. And I started thinking about this too. To deceive all of them would have been a great wonder to be able to do that. I know I've seen this last week. A child was watching a magician. And I know it's sleight of hand, and it's amazing what some of them can do. But there was a child that, while they were doing a card trick, he popped off exactly, and he actually, gave away his secret, and it just flabbergasted the magician, and it was a professional magician. So in our mind, this ain't something that Jesus deceived us with. It wasn't something that we were, just taking at his word. This is something, it's a fact. And we know here, too, that a lot of these people, to be able to deceive all of them, would be a great wonder, because a lot of them were very skeptical about what Jesus was saying, right? They were very skeptical. So if it wasn't right, they sure wouldn't have said that. So I just want to encourage you, too, to know that it's a fact established by many infallible truths. Now, if we look at Acts chapter 1, verse 3, mentions here, it says, to whom also, this is Luke speaking here,
says, to whom also he showed himself alive after his passion. And passion there is talking about the suffering and things that he went through. It says, by many infallible proofs, being seen of them 40 days, and speaking of the things pertaining to the kingdom of God. So even after that, he's still, pointing people to the Father, amen, and following through with what the kingdom of God, what God has in store. So the word infallible there, notice, this is for somebody here this morning, to whom also showed himself alive after his passion, meaning infallible proofs. Infallible in Greek means tetmeron. Again, I'm not no English major. But that means, listen to me, something surely and plainly known. So when we talk about the resurrection of Christ, if we were to put this up for debate, if we was to put witnesses there, all of these witnesses, he arose, amen?
Amen.
He rose from the dead. He's alive today. If we could take two witnesses, one witness, and convict someone for a crime, all of these people, he could not deceive every one of them. So we know, again, we can take it in our heart that he is risen. We also see, I'm just going to touch on a few verses here, verse 17 through 19 of 1 Corinthians chapter 15. It says that if Christ be not raised, your faith is vain. Ye are yet in your sins. Then they also which are fallen asleep in Christ are perished. If in this life we have hope in, or only we have hope in Christ, we are of all men most miserable. So that resurrection hope, if Christ be not raised, then based where we're at, we're lost, hell-bound sinners. And that's all we'll ever be. Amen? That's all we'll ever be. If Christ be not raised, every one of us is still in our sins. Believers, over the course of time that have died and gone on, they would just have perished, right? That's what it said there. If he be not raised, that word miserable there means to be pitied. We would be pitied if Christ be not risen. If Christ be not raised, there is no hope for man. If we look in Romans chapter 5, verse 10, it says, for if when we were enemies, we were reconciled to God by the death of his Son, much more being reconciled, we shall be saved by his life. What Jesus has done, amen? There's nothing we can do on our own. It's what Jesus has done. So it's good news. So today I'm telling you, we've got good news. We have a hope. It'd be like somebody coming up to me, and I was reading J. Vernon McGee, y'all know I love to listen and read, and I was reading his commentary this week, and I just thought this was a good, talking about good news. What Jesus has done. He's paid the price for us. He's done everything on our end. Even while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. Amen. But it'd be like somebody coming up and saying, Brother Wayne, I'm going to give you $1 million. And I'd be like, well, okay. I would like that just because I'd be able to quit work, go into full-time ministry. Yes, that'd be awesome. Help out. But then, okay, I've got to tell you this. I'll give you $1 million. You've got to work for 1,000 years. And over that time, you're going to get $1 million. Well, that doesn't sound good to you, does it? I got to work 1,000 years for what I don't think I'm. That ain't good news to me, okay? But I'm not crazy about working with anyone. But it's one of those things, that's not good news. But if somebody was to come up and say, hey, I'm going to give you $1 million, and you don't have to do anything, it's right here. That's good news. Now, when I say good news, that's good news if you're getting $1 million. But is it going to? It ain't going to get you to heaven, right? But what Jesus has done, and I know that's a, I'm just kind of showing you an analogy. In your mind, you're thinking, man, somebody just give me $1 million, man, I'd be sick. Well, guess what? One day, everything that's around us is going to burn. It's going to be gone. Nothing. All the houses we work for, the cars we work for, it's all going to be gone. Amen. When we go to heaven, we cannot take a
a U-Haul with us. We can't take it with us, right? I'm just being honest with you. Think about your spiritual health. Think about your heart. Think about where you're at. And this morning, if you can honestly say, I know I trusted Jesus Christ as my Savior. I know I'm ready to go to heaven. And it's all based on what He's done for you. Praise God, heaven is our home. Amen. If you're basing it on anything else other than that, if you're basing it on experience you've had when you were younger, you don't know for sure, you have doubt, make sure that Jesus Christ is your Lord and Savior. I know He saved me. He saved me. I didn't save myself. I couldn't work my way there. Amen. And everybody in our church, I promise you, we're not perfect. We're a messed up bunch of people. There's days, and I know like even Brother Brian said, I could really relate to this. There's days I don't like myself. I don't like me. That happens pretty often. And honestly, if you truly knew me like I knew me, you probably wouldn't like me at all. Amen. But I'm thankful I know Jesus. And because I trusted Jesus as my Lord and Savior, He paid that price. That heaven is my home. Amen. And I know that's where we look at it as far as monetary wise, but we have the good news. We have a hope beyond this life. We can also look at the resurrection of the dead in verses 22 through 23 of 1 Corinthians chapter 15. It says, for as in Adam all died, even so in Christ shall all be made alive. But every man in his own order, Christ the first fruits, afterward they that are Christ at his coming. But we notice here too that nothing but confusion can come from those that think Paul is speaking just of a general resurrection at the last day. And the dead refers to those who had fallen asleep in Christ, as we read earlier in verse 18. But notice in verse 22, it says, even so in Christ shall be made alive. It says, all are in Adam. But today I'm here to tell you, not all are in Christ. And how we know, in Adam it talks about all die. The proof you are in Adam is that you're going to die. Until the Lord, unless the Lord tarries his coming, you know, if it's 1,000 years, the statistic is one out of one person is going to die. That's a pretty good statistic, right? I'm not a mathematician either, but to think about one out of one person is going to die. Unless, listen to me, unless the rapture of the church takes place. But notice it says, even so, we go back to verse 22, it says, even so, in Christ. In Christ shall be made alive. This morning, make sure that you're in Christ. I'm not asking what your last name is. I'm not asking anything about our history, where we grew up, are you in Christ? It's what Christ has done in your life. That's the only way we're going to make it to heaven. We can also, we're not going to read it, but through 35 through 49, you can look at the resurrection body. We see in verse 35 that Paul, he now raises a double question here. Notice it says, some men will say, how were the dead raised? And with what body do they come? Now, notice it will not be the same body that is sown in the grave or in the ground. Can you say amen? I figured I'd get more amens than that. Makes you glad they can be the same body. It will be a God-given body. It'll be pleasing to Him, worthy of the redeemed spirit. It will be a body suited to the individual spirit. But notice in verse 42. It says, so also is the resurrection of the dead. It is sown in corruption. It is raised in incorruption. We'll have an incorruptible body. It'll be free from death, free from decay, free from disease, free from cancer. Amen. I know we've had people in our church, and we just went through cancer. I had a uncle of mine, Uncle Kenny was his name, and He was saved. He was Church of Christ. He went to church every time the doors was open. And that's one thing I know people may say things, but I'm telling you, they're faithful. They're right there, they're faithful to the church. And Kenny Buddy, he was there every time the doors was open. But I knew he was saved. And he was very athletic. Went back when we were younger, growing up, he loved baseball. He'd come watch us play. My papa on my mom's side, he loved baseball too. And they had, I'll never forget where their house was at, they had three wooden bats. One of them was real heavy, one of them was kind of light, and one of them was even lighter than that. And they'd have softballs, baseballs. They kept it in just on the back porch in a little utility room. And have y'all ever played Flies and Skinners? Okay, Gary knows about Flies and Skinners. You know what that is, don't you? If it hits you a ball, it's in the air, you catch it. They get 2 points. That's a fly. And a skinner is a ground ball. That's all it is. I mean, it's just if you catch it on the ground, you get a point. Like that. And that's how we played it. That's Flies and Skinners. So when you're outside playing, you know, you say, hey, you don't play Flies and Skinners? And just mesmerize people. I don't know what you're talking about. But he was very athletic. I mean, we played golf. I mean, he loved it. He just loved the outside. He had just a joy of life. I mean, when I say joy, like, he was always around and he was always cutting up. You know the joke, how you put shaving cream on your hand, you tickle somebody's nose? Me and my brother Johnny did that to him. And what's bad about it, he was asleep in his chair. He had a chair. We always watch sports all the time. And what was bad is he actually did it one time. His hand went back down. We did it a second time before he realized it. So, but Kenny, but Kenny was a very, very athletic, and I remember. I used to say his ankle or his legs got as small as my wrist, but I'm a big boy, so it's probably smaller than that. He just withered away from that. He took his last breath. It just broke my heart. It just broke my heart. But I'm thankful to know that he knew Christ as his Lord and Savior. Now, he's going to have an incorruptible body. Amen. Next time I see him, he's not going to be struggling. Amen. Ain't you glad to know what happened to him? Like that old song, I have anybody, praise the Lord, I have anybody. Amen. Ain't you glad that that's the case? But and the good news is it's going to be free from death, disease, decay, cancer. It'll be a body of glory. It'll be like his own glorified body. It'll be a body of power. It'll be a spiritual body. We can look in 1 John chapter 3, verse 2, where it says, Beloved, now are we the sons of God, and it did not yet appear while we shall be. But we know that when he shall appear, we shall be like him, for we shall see him as he is. Amen?
Amen.
We'll have a resurrection body one day after a while. We also see the resurrection mystery as we get to verse 51 of 1 Corinthians chapter 15. It says, Behold, I show you a mystery. The apostle, he reveals a truth that has been veiled, although revealed to all the children of God, that they shall not die, but that they shall all be changed. Now, when it talks about a mystery here, when the word mystery is used, it's not something mysterious or you can't figure it out. It's just something that's never been revealed before. And what that's talking about is the rapture of the church. The rapture could take place any moment. That's the next thing in God's timeline. It could happen today. It's in God's time. We don't know. I can't tell you when it's going to happen. The Lord himself will come, and those who are alive and remain at the time shall be called up together with those who have fallen asleep in Christ, who shall then be raised from the dead. We see that. We're not going to look there in 1 Thessalonians chapter 14, verse 18. But notice in verse 52, we shall not all sleep, we shall not all die, but we shall all be changed. It says, in a moment, in the twinkling of an eye, at the last trumpet, the trumpet shall sound, and the dead shall be raised incorruptible. That's our incorruptible body, amen. And we shall be changed, for this corruptible must put on incorruption, and this mortal
must put on immortality, so that when this corruptible shall have put on incorruption, this mortal body shall have put on immortality, then shall be brought to pass to say that is written. Listen to me this morning. Death is swallowed up in victory. Amen.
Amen.
And we see earlier, I didn't read the verse, but one of the last enemies in verse 26, the last enemy that shall be destroyed is death. Amen.
Yeah.
It's all about what God has done. In the twinkling of an eye. Just in the millisecond that it takes. It's not even blinking an eye. I mean, you watch somebody, you may not can see it, but it's just that little twinkle there right before it happens. That in the twinkling of an eye. We also see redemption's song here in verse 54. It says, death is swallowed up in victory. O death, where is thy sting? O grave, where is thy victory? The sting of death is sin, and the strength of sin is the law. But listen, but thanks be to God, which giveth us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. Think about resurrection song. Death is swallowed up in victory. Victory over the power of sin. Brother Mickey Crane, y'all know he was a mentor of mine. He's gone on to be with the Lord. One thing he would say at times, he said, one day after a while, I'll never fail him again. You just feel like you just fail God all the time, like whatever the case may be. But he's like, one day I'll never fail him again. We'll be delivered from the power of sin. O grave, where is thy victory? Death and grave, once you have claimed these bodies, we have eternally defeated death and these incorruptible bodies. It's a song of praise as well of triumph. He alone can swallow up death and victory. Now, if we look here in the New Testament, I want to share with you two verses of Scripture in the Old Testament that show complete fulfillment. What is happening here. But go to Isaiah chapter 25, verse 8. You see, and this is what he says here. He says, he will swallow up death in victory, and the Lord God will wipe away tears from all faces, and the rebuke of all of his people shall he take away from off all the earth, for the Lord hath spoken. Hosea chapter 13, verse 14 also makes mention. Hosea said, I will ransom them, he writes this, I will ransom them from the power of the grave. I will redeem them from death. O death, I will be thy plagues. O grave, I will be thy destruction. Repentance shall be hid from my eyes. I love that. It says, O grave, I will be thy destruction. He's going to tell you, that's the last enemy, amen. He's going to take it down. We don't have to fear death. You don't have to fear all of it. As a Christian, as a child of God, heaven is our home, amen? And ain't you glad? I mean, aren't you glad that you know that? That you know, that you know, that you know. It's not anything you've done. I'm not good enough. It's what Jesus has done in my life. Now let's look at verse 58, and I'm going to spend just a minute in closing. It says, therefore, my beloved brethren, so, brethren, who is he talking to? He says, brethren, he's talking to Christians, right? Blessed my beloved brethren, be steadfast, unmovable, always abounding in the work of the Lord, for as much as you know that your labor is not in vain. Notice, it says, in the Lord. So we have a, I guess you could say, an incentive as the resurrection is concerned with this exhortation here full of power and seeing what awaits us. You know, what manner of person do we need to be? There should be a stability of character. And there should be a stability of integrity, amen, in our lives. And what we've got to do, too, and I've run across this in my years of ministry, really not to let the unbelief of others turn you aside from the faith of this gospel. Don't let anybody talk to you about it. Don't let the unbelief of others. Jesus is what we all have to receive. You know, my wife, I love
other than be an example of her healing sake. It's her decision. Just like if she's prayed for me as a husband that's lost and undone, there's nothing that she can do other than nothing she does can make me accept Christ. Right? Amen? Love my grandkids. You know, pray every day. You know, they get that age accountability. They accept Christ. My kids, they say things over my kids. Jacob over there, you know, I can want it for them, but it's their decision. Amen? We accept Christ. And as a church, as a pastor, you know, I can want it for you all day long. But when it comes down to it, it's your decision to follow Christ and what God has done. There's nothing I can do for you. I can show you in Scripture. I know we do share this about fear. We've been through that. But there's a point in your life this morning. You're hearing that call. That knock on your door. That knock on your heart. And all you got to do is just let Him in. Let Him in your life. Repent of your sin. Make Him Lord and King of your life. Because He's done it for you. You may be sitting there, and there may be people all over the world still skeptical. You know, about, you know, that's old stuff. I mean, that don't even have anything to do with today, you know, that kind of thing. But I tell you right now, we know, as a child of God, we have faith knowing that He has rose from the dead. He's alive forevermore. And so the good news is, as a child of God, I'm going to pick on the Christians here today. There should be a consistency in service in your life to Christ. Consistency. You know, as a Christian, we want just enough Jesus to be saved. We want just enough Jesus to be delivered from hell. I know Brian Bridges shared that this week. But that's honestly true. We want just enough to be able to say, I'm going to heaven. And we want you to make that decision if God's knocking on your heart's door. That's not all there is. If I walk out those doors, I go my merry way during the week, and as a Christian, definitely as a pastor, if I'm not telling others about Jesus, then I'm failing God. I'm not being consistent. If I'm challenging you to share Jesus, and I'm not willing to share Jesus, something's wrong, isn't it? I'm challenging you. The time's running short. We've got to wake up. And today, as a you may be sitting here today and think, well, what do I do to be able to accept Christ? Well, first thing you've got to do is realize you're a sinner. There's a lot of people out there, they don't admit they're sinners. Says in Romans 3:23, all of sin comes short of the glory of God. If you've been in church any of your life, you've heard that. If you've been in church here in the last 6 years, you've heard that. We talk about it all the time, right? All of sin comes short of the glory of God. You know the wages of sin is different. You're going to get a payday one day after a while. But notice the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ. Then we must understand your need to be saved. And you can be saved because we know Jesus Christ, God's Son, died for you. But then this is the hard part that some people don't want to take up any further. They're fine up there. It says, then you must repent and turn from your sins. Repent and turn from your sins. The Bible says it's wrong, it's wrong. The Bible says it's right, it's right. You've got to turn from your sins. Place your faith in Christ to be saved. And we know it also says, whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. Now, Shelly comes to play a verse of invitation this morning. I know we come from a lot of different areas, and maybe God has spoken to your heart. It talks about the resurrection of Christ, how it's an infallible proof. It is something sure, and it is plainly known. It's not up to faith. Town of First Baptist Church in the city. Amen? Not a debate. We know that without a shadow of doubt.
We know the resurrection hope. We know the resurrection of the dead. We know that resurrection body. We know that mystery that the rapture of the church one day is going to take us on home. And it's only those that are saved that's going. Only those that know Jesus Christ as the Lord and Savior are going. Don't be left behind. And then also as a child of God, what are we doing about it? We don't need to waver. We don't need to change direction. We don't need to fall or quit. Because He's alive and our labor is not in vain. Amen. It's not in vain. You may be thinking, man, I do it all, but I'm telling you, it's not in vain before the Lord. No priest had many years. Didn't see a convert, 120 years. He did what God told him to do. But your labor is not in vain. Amen. But let's bow our heads, and maybe today that you want to admit you're a sinner, you realize the wages of sin is death. You want to be saved, you can be saved. But maybe you want to just pray this in your heart, and if you're not praying this to God, it's just words. It don't even have to be like this. Just accept Christ as your Savior. But maybe in your heart you want to say, "Dear Lord Jesus, I know I'm a sinner. I know You died for my sins. Right now, I invite You into my heart to be my Savior and Lord. I turn away from my sin and I give my life to You. Thank You for saving me. Amen." Keep your heads bowed. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. God, I come to You today as humble as I know how. God, thank You for the resurrection of Christ. Because we know that if we did not have that resurrection, we would have no gospel. Everything we'll be doing will be in vain. God, I pray this morning for every soul that's in here. God, You know the need. God, You know everything about them. You know everything about me. And I pray if everybody here is a Christian, God, that You would help them leave here today and be challenged to spread the good news that Your Son is alive. Lord, I pray this morning, anybody here that's lost and undone, that knows that if it were to die today, hell would be their home. God, we pray, Lord, that You would touch them as only You can, God, save them. And Lord, I pray today if there's anyone under the sound of my voice, God, to pray that prayer sincerely to You. God, it's not to me, it's not to this church. God, it's to You. Help them step out. Make that decision. God, I pray again for this church. God, thank You for what it means to me. And I pray, God, that You would do a mighty work with